request for a donation of Odom Dillon, DBA chairman. Mr. Baker.
Council, my name is Ted Baker, 724 Edgewater Place, Tate, Iowa. I'm chairman of the Downtown Development Authority, and I come here today to request that the city council deed the Odom building over to the Downtown Development Authority with the condition that you will maintain your current financial support of the building until such time as we can get it sold or move on to some other property owner. I want to go over just a little bit of a brief history of how this come to pass and why we're making this request. Approximately 2011, the building was donated to the city of Hayhire. 2014, Alderman Barrett did a study as to the condition of the building and the cost of bringing it up to a standard to where something could be done with it. It was not a complete construction cost, and it was in the neighborhood of, I think, almost $870,000. Pretty healthy pipes. And the building there is in pretty bad disrepair. 2016, the DDA was formed. We had a training session. We had a first meeting, which Barrett and Altman presented us with an update of the building and with inflation and construction costs. They estimated it would be closer to $900,000 to $1 million to bring the building up to a point for where somebody could finish the renovations. And that's a tremendous chunk to take on for a building in that kind of disrepair. This is what one of the advantages of having an authority is, and this is why authorities were formed for working with the city. The authorities can deal directly with individuals. We have advantages. We're better prepared to do that, that the cities simply don't have, the municipalities don't have. The Georgia Department of Community Affairs is one of many agencies that offers programs. I think we have a list of about 140 different programs that they offer to assist in this sort of renovation and upkeep of buildings, of which our staff has identified approximately 20 that would lend itself directly to the city of Hayhire. Again, these are things that DDAs can take advantage of. Municipalities just simply can't do it. It's advantageous to the city to have this building preserved, renovated, active, and back on the city tax rolls as opposed to sitting there. Now, it's been in like 5 years, hasn't been much activity. I believe that once the DDA was formed, that inquiries are beginning to come in. I think there's some things that we can do, and we're in a position to move on it now. The authority has asked me to come before the council and make this request. This is to deed the building over to the DDA with the proviso, the condition that y'all continue the support. And I don't know if you have blanket policies or individual policies, but to maintain it until such time as we can get it back when it's on the street, renovated and sold or rented out somewhere. And I will entertain whatever questions you have at this time.
Have any questions for Mr. Rankin?
Once you take possession, how quick do you think you can move on a program to rehabilitate this property?
Well, there's two avenues. One would be what they call speculative. This is where the authority would take it upon themselves to seek out grant money and to seek out, well, probably rotating loans or revolving loans or something like that. And eventually we'd have to pay those back, and I think they stand out. And there are many, many different programs, so there are no absolutes. Something in the neighborhood of like 2 years, then somebody wants their money back, and by that time we will have to have done something. The other avenue would be a straight out sale where we could possibly put some incentive packages together, taking advantage of some of these programs, bundle the package with the building, and make a sale directly to an individual or a corporation. And it's just a matter of who comes, how much money they have, and how badly they want the property. That could be, you know, whenever somebody walks in.
In other words, the second option there is probably the one to move the building much more quickly.
With a direct sale to an individual?
That's right.
Yes. Okay, you're right. That was the second option. The longer option would take, you know, construction time, investment time, and then you always are flexible enough. Somewhere in that process, somebody may come in and say, I want it. I want it with what you've got. I want these incentives, and then I want to finish it on my own. Those are all options that are on the table, and we have the flexibility to be able to deal with individuals like that.
Say the option came where a private investor or a company came and decided that they were interested in buying. Would it be advantageous if that property be in the hands of the DDA in relation to it being in the hands of the city at the time someone came up with that type of an interest?
If they wanted some incentives, not they just had tons of money and didn't need the tax credits or didn't need the low interest loans or didn't need any additional grant money, so much the better, it wouldn't make any difference. But those kind of deals don't come along. And investors who are sitting on the sidelines, they know what DDAs are, they know what authorities can do, and that's what they come in and ask. What kind of incentives do you have? What kind of packages can you put together? So it's the package that goes with the deal that gets these properties moved along.
If I could just chime in real quick, there's also limitations on how a city can sell its property that would create advantages to bringing it to a DDA. City property has to be sold for some limitations in the code, basically put out for bid and that sort of thing. But there are exceptions, one of which is a transfer or a sale to another governing authority or government agency, which a DDA qualifies. The DDA is then free to negotiate whatever deal it wants to negotiate with a prospective purchaser. Of course, once the city deeds the property, it no longer controls the property. But there's many, many ways a deal like this can be structured. But the DDA is going to have a whole lot more flexibility as far as how it can kind of facilitate the development than the city could. Just because of the limitations on how cities can sell.
Are there strings on that transfer of the deed from the city, or is it just go over, is it pretty clean?
Well,
the transfer.
Here's one. If the city is looking to retain some control over the end, you know, what happened to the building, and one possible scenario would be that it is disclosed as kind of a package deal that the developers found a deal is worked out as far as exactly what they're going to do with the property, how they're going to pay for it. And then you just have kind of a two-step closing where the city says, yeah, that sounds good. The city transfers the property to the DDA, the DDA then sells it. Your contract with the contract between the DDA and the developer would have all the restrict or the requirements that you will develop it this way, you'll have it completed by this time, you know, whatever restrictions are negotiated.
Is that between the DDA and the developer, or between the city and the DDA on the transfer of the title for the deed?
Well, if you did it the way, it was just kind of a three-way transaction, I think everybody would be at the table as part of those discussions. If the city, you know, the city can transfer ownership to the DDA and let the DDA run with it. It can absolutely do that under the code. If you're trying to kind of keep your finger on the pulse of what's going to happen with the property, you still do it that way, but maybe you just don't transfer it until later on.
Well, and if I can offer too, the council, of course, went through a lot of time and effort to create this Downtown Development Authority over the past several some odd years. There was a long and considered approach to its formation and to the appointment of the members that are on the authority itself. So, of course, it's up to the council whether or not it wants to give the authority jurisdiction over the building and have those seven members decide essentially what will occur to it, or if the council would so choose to put restrictions on that.
I would just point out that you have a member of the council on the authority, so
yeah, it's the same direction I didn't mean to say. I don't think we need any. The point of the authority is to develop the property in the best interest of the city, not to put in a nightclub or whatever else. The talking about the pulse of the development there at the building, you've been to the training, you're in charge of the DDA. I haven't been to one of the meetings yet. You gave two options for possibilities in terms of development. Is there an idea yet? Is this the first step towards figuring out which direction to go, or?
We all have individual ideas, but it's going to be who comes in with what offers, and then the offer to be considered. There have been inquiries. Again, we'll have to wait till we see something tangible, and then we'll weigh them. If there are good offers, we might go with it. If we think we can do better using the longer route, that's an option, but that's a decision that the whole city would have to get together and vote on. So I don't make decisions for them. All they depend.
Let me ask this question. Absent a developer on board, let's just say the DDA is moving forward on getting it up to snuff on the safety and stuff, the $1 million has to be spent. Are there funding sources for that $1 million other than just taking out a loan?
Yes, you have to defer to staff on this exactly, but there are, I understand, destruction grants. There's some grant monies, and then there are just a multitude of different types of loans. And none of that is guaranteed. We just have the authority to ask for it, to apply for it. We have a staff member who is a grant writer by profession in a former job, so we're quite confident that we can get through the paperwork. And if you want to elaborate on
that? Sure. The Federal Department of Housing and Urban Development has a number of national objectives that it is mandated underneath its creation by which to satisfy. A couple of those national objectives are assistance to low and moderate income persons. Low to moderate income is defined by each community. And they talked about that tax credit housing, the 80% rule and some of these others. There's another national objective called elimination of slum and blight, which is also a source of funding. Now, Congress allocates the money to HUD. HUD disperses it to the states. So the states then receive a pot of funds, and then they divide it up based on how they think
those national objectives can be implemented. So the large majority of the funding that comes from the federal government is deposited into the low and moderate income assistance. And that basically takes the form of a regular round competition called CDBG. Community Development Block Grants are applied for around the state in a competitive process that each community can come up with a project such as public infrastructure,
sidewalks
and you know, drainage. And not to, you know, belabor the point, just to say that there's another set aside from that, that is elimination of slum and blight. And that's about $1.5 million every year. The funding limit's $500,000. And cities are the ones that have to apply, but an eligible use of that funding is a grant that the city receives and that is loaned to a downtown development authority at no interest, that can be deferred in terms of payment up to 24 months. Portions of it can be used as a grant for demolition. Portions, though, would have to be used as low-interest loan funding or no-interest loan funding, so it's repaid, but it's repaid back to the city. And then the city uses it as a revolving loan fund. We've done it in a couple, I did it in a couple other places before I came on board with the city. It's a pot of funding that's really not used very much because it is paperwork intensive and there's a lot of process that has to go through in order to qualify for it. Is the city of Hayhira eligible? Absolutely. Can they apply? It would be a decision up to the city. But it's $500,000 right there. Now there are other low interest loan programs that can be augmented and supplemented with this, potentially using the building's equity to go for the rest of it for a substantial portion. So there is a path that's there. I know $1 million has been thrown around a lot. We've heard amounts as low as $600,000 or something. And you know, that becomes very doable in that instance. Not that $1 million isn't doable, I feel like. So there are paths by which a DDA can get it done.
That building in perfect shape, what's it worth? I know that's a difficult question.
It was appraised at approximately $400,000.
In its current condition?
Yes. But it was appraised for the purposes of tax liability. So underneath that auspice, the building was donated to the city, and that liability was then granted, or I guess the reimbursement was granted to the donor. Is it worth that? Probably not. We do have the appraisals that dictate it, but it would then be up to the DDA to decide, are we going to take it and are we going to go the program route, or are we going to sell it to an interested developer that wants to use it now?
I dare say that probably that appraisal was done before the evaluation was done by Altman on the condition of the property.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So I think that after that appraisal, if another appraisal were done with that information available, you would probably find that building is worth, or they would appraise it a lot less.
I guess what I'm asking is, if you put $1 million into it, is it going to be worth $1 million?
I would say that the value of that building is incalculable. I mean, in terms of historic preservation. And I know I'm talking a lot, but Dr. Perry, just come into my office, former mayor of Hayhira, and said, Jonathan, how are we going to save these downtown buildings? What are we going to do in order to save our downtown? We've already lost the cigarette factory. We've already lost the depot. What are we going to do to save these buildings? And this is the response to that. This is what we're trying to do to see if we can.
There are also a lot of intangibles that go with preserving an icon like that building. It's one of the most architecturally significant buildings in North Georgia. I mean, this part of North Lyons County. It's the peripheral that is around it. Once that building's renovated, that's going to attract other interested parties, and then the tax base goes on and on and on and on and on, and the city will continuously, and at some point in time, well over $1 million, you know, down the road. Now, it may not be a sound business investment for someone to go in there, chunk down a bunch of money, and expect a quick turnaround, but municipalities have other things that they have to take into consideration. consideration, like what goes on around, what's it going to attract, what's it going to do to the community, and they can spread their payback over a much longer period of time, because they don't run like an independent business that has to have an immediate turnaround to make a profit instantly.
I think with the advent of our DEA, we're going to find that the developers, there are a lot of creative developers out there who have done these types of things. We might be surprised if you put that sort of thing out there. What would step forward and would be interested in taking that and doing something with it. I would only suggest this, that upon receiving this property, that's what we proceed to do. I think the first thing you would need to do before you start getting it is create your process for how you're going to proceed. Create a process. Don't go into it and just open the door and say, come in. I would create a process about how you're going to take a piece of property and the process of the bid, the process of how you're going to advertise it, all of these things. I think you need to get out and find people who've done this. And you don't have to reinvent the wheel. There are hundreds of DDAs that have done this.
Understood.
And finding out their processes and coming up with an official process for this is going to be something that you're going to be glad that you did.
We have two processes. One is sale and how it can do and how you assemble packages. And the other is the longer term where we take it upon ourselves to do grants and various loans over a two-year period of time, and then market it. But we have to be flexible enough that anywhere along the line for that process. And you're right, that has been done before. It's not like we're trying to create a wheel. And we have people who have been through it before.
That's right. You're right. You got great asset and Jonathan and people that we talked to in the past.
And these fellow board members are all experienced business people.
I think you're right. And I have great confidence in your ability to sit down and work this out. I just know that when you first get into something, there's a lot of excitement involved, but sometimes you got to cut through the blindness of, you know, I know when guys go out, I deal with this all the time. I got coaches who go out and recruit players, and a 6'8", 280-pound guy walk in the room, and all they can see is this great football
superstar.
But behind that, there are so many intangibles. Where has he been to school? Why is a 6'8", 280 coming to Valdosta State? What is the academic background? What is the reputation of the player? They're, you can get blinded by the excitement of the initial, hey, here we go. And forget there are details that you got to take care of. And that would be my only suggestion here is that this is an exciting time for us. Let's make sure that we cross our T's and dot our I's on a specific process that Jonathan, I know that you can help them with. If we decide to open this up to outside and try to encourage it, how do we throw that out there? How do we advertise it? What are we looking for when we advertise it?
This project is not a Johnny Football. It is a Johnny Nice.
Okay. I understand. This is 6'8", 300 4HB. I understand that. For us, that's what it is. And I'm excited for you. I've just been in too many development positions in the past in my profession that sometimes you need to make sure that you have your processes in place before you proceed.
Yeah, lots.
Don't make it up as you go on.
Absolutely not. We've got outsiders.
Right.
Tutoring us.
Good.
I agree with Councilman Barfield that definitely you need to make a plan and make sure everything is ready to go. I also believe, you know, what the city manager was alluding to, you know, this DDA was created very carefully over a long period of time with a lot of questioning and a lot of vetting, and it was put together in a very good way. Got great group. They're ready to go with something. And that's what they're there for. That's what the DDA is there for. And I believe that put it better than Councilman Barfield, but I don't think that
would be easy. Just start talking.
I think that the DDA is in its infancy, but I think there's a lot behind the scenes that on the road that we've gotten here to where we are. We've come up with a group that can do this. I have confidence, too, in the DDA being able to do that. And the last thing I'll say is, most importantly, with regard to this particular question, should we or shouldn't we go ahead and beat this over? I think we should, because as you stated, there's several different avenues to take. And really the question before the council is, should the avenues be taken further with the DDA, with the Odom building property being still in the hands of the city, or should it be with the DDA? And we've answered this in several different ways, that the DDA's process, whatever that may be ultimately, is going to be much smoother and less restricted and less cumbersome than if it stays in the hands of the city. You can't really start the process until you have the property. I'm not in a hurry to make sure that it's built next week or renovated within a few months. But to get started, you really need that property in hands to even solicit information with some people. I myself would like to find out more information from successful DDAs around the state, like Tifton, even though that's a different animal than the type of DDA that we have right now here in Hayhara. But I think, from what I've seen in the meetings with the DDA, that no one has the intention of moving forward without making sure every I is dotted and T is crossed. I'm confident of that. The process will be much smoother. In fact, I don't even think it's going to be very difficult to even get started until the property is in the hands of the DDA. So with that, I would suggest granting this request.
And I've already informed you that John's from this, and that's why I'm probably speaking from night and normally would. But I'm not going to be here Thursday night, so I just want to express my support of that as well.
Thank you for doing that. Take that as a vote of confidence. The people you appointed to that board. Thank you. Yeah.